Assalamu alaikum. Jazakum Allah khair. Brother, I just want your opinion or your thinking about the people who do tabligh. That they only, they're doing it with their good intentions, please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they're going out to seek Muslim people that are, being so like diverted from the religion to bring them to the masjid. That's all they do. I don't know if you know about it, but they've got set rules,
The brother Stella Khair, he asks a question regarding a group of people, a particular group from our lands, originally from India and Pakistan, called Jamaat al-Tabligh. And they go and they give tabligh. The meaning of tabligh is they call the people, they give da'wah. And the intention is, as the brother mentions, to bring people back to Islam, And my opinion regarding this group. Firstly, any group of people, there's goodness and there's badness. Any group of people, there's some good and there'll be some mistakes. And when we mention these mistakes, then we're not talking about their intentions. Because as I mentioned, it's not permitted for us to talk about their intention, what's in their heart. Like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Samad ibn Zayd, have you opened up his chest? So it's not permitted for us to talk about their intention. But we look at their actions, and these actions have to be weighed up with the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And their statements have to be weighed up with the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first question that we have to ask is a da'wah and a tabligh. Is this ibadah? Is this an act of worship or is it not an act of worship? And no doubt it's an act of worship, it's an ibadah. And therefore, as we mentioned, if it is an act of worship, then it has to be done according to the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Meaning, you call to that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called to. You warn against that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned against. You prioritize those things which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prioritized, and so on and so forth. And if you look at this group, as I mentioned, every group, there's good and there's bad. But if you look at this group, and if you look at the books that this group based their beliefs upon, and the scholars that they refer back to, then you will see in these books an aqidah, a belief, in which there are mistakes and misguidance and deviations. From among these mistakes is in terms of aqidah. So if you were to ask them, tell me about Allah, tell me about the names and attributes of Allah, then they don't have belief in the names and attributes of Allah like the Salaf used to have. They would say, for example, Allah is everywhere. And yet in the Quran and the statements of the Prophet and the Sahaba and the Salaf, all of them affirm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above His throne. Ar-Rahman wa al-Arshistawa. So this is a mistake. Another mistake is that in terms of the suluk or the tariqah, they themselves, they go back to at-tasawuf. They say our tariqah is tariqah sufiyya. And as most of you know here, the tariqah sufiyya is the tariqah which is deep in shirk and innovations. And also the fact that they don't give much importance to at-tawheed. In fact, sometimes you will hear them say, don't talk too much about at-tawheed because it disunites the people, and we just want to bring people together. But as I mentioned, we talk about those things which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about, even if it disunites the people. And we don't talk about those things which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not speak about. And many other things. Now, brother, where are you from? Which country?
Algeria.
So the brother is from Algeria. Jamaat al-Tabligh, as I mentioned, the origin is from our lands, from India and Pakistan. And sometimes there's a difference between Jamaat al-Tabligh in our countries and the face that Jamaat al-Tabligh show in the Arab countries. For example, in our countries, in our language, the book that they give their followers is a book called Fadail al-A'mal. and another one called the Tarbiyah Islam. And I'm not any expert in Jamaat Tarbiyah, but from what I know, I've sat with them a few times. The book which they give to the Arabs is Riyad al-Salihin. So the Arab will say, what's wrong with Jamaat Tarbiyah? They only give Riyad al-Salihin. And the reason why there is a difference, because generally speaking, our Arab brothers, because they know some of the Arabic language, because they know the Arabic language, and because they're a bit more aware of misguidances and doubts, they give them a particular book. And yet, when it comes to the Ajam, those who don't know the Arabic language, another book is given. And this book, has been mentioned by many scholars, it contains weaker hadith, and you know, strange things, mentions about the awliya and things like this, which is known with the Sufiya. So the brothers who know this, know this. As I mentioned, every group has good and it has bad. So we're not saying that Jama'at Tabligh, all of it is evil, and there's no goodness in it at all, and the people are all evil, and they don't have any goodness in them, and they intend evil, no. They intend goodness. They want goodness. They want Tabligh. They want to aid the religion. This is their intention. But the way in which they are doing so, unfortunately, is a way which is in opposition to the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wallahu a'lam. I hope that's enough.
Yeah, I want to ask you about the end of every prayer with Salah. I mean, some extra shukran for Sajda for Shukran. But then there's Badat or not Badat.
So do the Shukran?
Shukran, yeah.
After the prayer?
After the end of prayer, when I finish Sajda Shukran,
I don't know of any hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do an extra sujood after the prayer. Yes, there's sujood the sahu. If you forget something in the prayer, if you add something, or if you leave something, or you have a doubt, then you make sujood the sahu. But after the prayer, to make another sujood the shukr, then this isn't established. This is innovation. If this is what you're referring to, Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after the prayer, it's known that he used to stay in his place for a long time and he used to make dhikr. And this dhikr was done quietly, individually, and this dhikr has been mentioned in many, many hadith. Allahumma inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. Oh Allah, help me upon your dhikr and your shukr and upon worshipping you well. So, if this is an action which people are doing, and I'm not seeing this, that people are making a special sujood the shukr, then look at the Prophet Shaitan. The remembrance which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to make, with and mention the word shukr, they don't do. The established sunnah. And yet they do an action which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not used to do. So the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after the prayer is this. Make the adhkar. As for making a separate sujood after the prayer for shukr, then I don't know of an evidence for this. It becomes a bid'ah. If it's not a sunnah, then it's a bid'ah. Because it's an act of worship, which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not used to do, then it becomes a bid'ah.
So, in which term actually it comes to bid'ah? Because the shukran sujood, or the making dua in congregation,
yeah.
The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sometimes did it.
Yeah.
So, is it you referring bid'ah because someone brought these two ibadah together, or is it something else?
Are you asking about making dua in
congregation?
Yeah. How is making dua in congregation a bid'ah? This is the question. Yeah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as you mentioned, in certain instances he made dua, certain instances he did not make dua. Certain instances he made dua in congregation, the people would say Ameen. Other instances the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't make dua in congregation and they didn't used to say Ameen. Therefore, to do an act continuously and make it a routine and make it expected upon the people that after you finish the prayer, you have to make a dua in congregation, you have to raise your hand, you have to say Ameen, which the Prophet ﷺ did not do in this time, then this becomes an innovation. Whenever you specify something which the Prophet ﷺ did not specify, then it becomes an innovation. As an example, as you mentioned, the Prophet ﷺ used to make dua. So if you, for example, wake up one day, 12 p.m. on a Thursday, you make dua, alhamdulillah. 1 p.m. you make dua, alhamdulillah. Any time of the day you make dua, alhamdulillah. As soon as you say that we should be making dua at 2 p.m. on a Thursday, this now becomes an innovation. Why? Because you have specified a time which the Prophet did not specify. If you were to do it as a coincidence, you wanted to make dua, you made dua and it was 2 o'clock. Not with any intention, not because you're specifying this time, you believe because this time has a special virtue or blessing, there's no problem. But as soon as you specify this time, 2 p.m., and you tell people to do it, then this becomes an innovation now. Or you do dua in a particular way which the Prophet ﷺ did not do. Or, for example, reciting, as an example, Surah Al-Ikhlas. Alhamdulillah, it's good. Recited it once, 10 times, 100 times, recited 1,000 times in the day, Alhamdulillah, it's all good. But as soon as you say that people should recite Qul Huwa Allah Ahad 17 times on a Thursday, as an example, it becomes an innovation. So if you were to do the action without any intention, you just did the action, no problem. As soon as you specify it, and you start telling the people, and you make it a routine, it becomes an innovation, a bid'ah. And therefore it's rejected, and you're not allowed to do it. Now, many times I've gone into the masjid, in various masjid, sometimes I've had to lead the prayer, and you turn around, and you start making dhikr. And the people are waiting, and there's an awkward silence. And then they come to you, our prayer is not complete. Why? You didn't make dua. So can you see now how they've introduced something into the religion which the Prophet ﷺ didn't used to do so. More than this, now they think that their prayer isn't complete if you don't make this dua. And the Prophet ﷺ didn't used to do so. In fact, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentioned that the Prophet ﷺ, he never made dua immediately after the prayer. There's a reason for this. The reason is that there are certain times in the day that a person should make dua, extra dua. Certain times and situations. For example, when it's raining, between the adhan and the iqamah, Yom Arafah, when you're fasting, if you're oppressed, when you're visiting an ill person, and other times that you should make dua. Two other important times, in your sujood, and also before you make a taslim. The Prophet ﷺ said, مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِ وَهُوَ فِي السُّجُودِ. That there is no other place and no other situation in which a slave is closest to his Lord than when he is making sujood. And then he said, so you know, make a dua in your sujood. So the Prophet ﷺ, he never left something which was better and did something which wasn't as good. And for this reason, he never left making sujood, dua in his sujood, and then instead do it in a time where it isn't as good as this. But if you look at the Muslims now, who amongst us makes dua in the sujood? Subhanallah, and get up. Does anybody make dua in the sujood? What was the famous dua that the Prophet ﷺ used to make in the sujood? Who knows? Famous dua the Prophet used to make in the sujood? All the time the sujood used to make this dua.
Ya muqallibal
qulub. Thabbit qalbi ala deenik. Look, this dua, which the Prophet ﷺ used to make in his sujood, Ya muqallibal qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik, from the congregation, one or two people know. And yet, making dua after the prayer, everybody does this. So can you see how shaitan, he takes the people away from the established sunnah, which the Prophet ﷺ used to do, and towards innovation which the Prophet ﷺ did not used to do. How many people now in some of the masajid, they sit and they make a dhikr? Very few of them. And yet almost all of them in the masajid, they're making dua in congregation. So that which the Prophet ﷺ used to do, and is an established sunnah, they don't do it. That which the Prophet ﷺ never used to do, they do it and they make an obligation upon the people. And this is from the plots of a shaitan. Remember, shaitan, when it comes to the believers, sometimes if the person's heart is corrupt, he comes with a big sin. And this person falls into sinning or kufr and disbelief and a'udhu billah. Sometimes he will give him two options which are both evil, but he tries to take him towards a bigger evil. Sometimes there might be two actions which are good, this is his last attempt. That there's two options which are good, but try to make him do the less good. At least he doesn't do the big good. This is how desperate the shaitan is. So shaitan has all of these plots. And one of these plots is making people think that something is good when in reality it isn't good, and leaving off something which is actually God. And for this reason, you know, many of the companions and the Salaf, they say that from the most beloved actions to Shaitan is innovations. Shaitan loves innovations more than disobedience. Why? Because sinning and disobedience, for example, a person smokes, a person lies, na'udhu billah, a person drinks alcohol or commits zina, na'udhu billah. He knows when he's doing this action that this is wrong. He knows that this is evil. Even when he does it, he knows. You know, anybody has a bit of iman in their heart, they know that this action is not good. Our shabab, our youth who are listening to music on the streets, if you tell them don't, they know, they say, look, we know that it's wrong. It's a mistake that we're falling into. But the person who does an innovation, he thinks this is the religion. And therefore you will notice this, that sometimes talking to a person who is, you know, a Muslim who's drinking alcohol, who's on the streets, who's committing sin, to give dawah to him is sometimes easier than, and he's more accepting than giving dawah to somebody who's in innovations. Because this one's stubborn, because he says, no, this is the religion. But this one, he knows that this is even it is wrong. So anyway, I digress, but this is the reason why we say that these actions, they are innovations. There's a question from the sisters regarding al-bay'ah, giving allegiance. We need to understand what is the meaning of giving bay'ah, the pledge of allegiance. The bay'ah, it's an obligation in our religion. It has to be done in our religion. And the objective behind bay'ah is to unite the Muslims. Remember, this sharia, this blessed religion that Allah has favored upon us, it has many objectives. From amongst the objectives, the maqasid of the sharia is to protect the religion of the people, the Muslims, to protect the wealth of the Muslims, to protect the honor of the Muslims, to protect the strength and the unity of the Muslims. This is from the maqasid of sharia, from the objectives of our religion. In many, many things, and this is a lecture in itself, the importance of unity and how Islam tries to protect the unity of the Muslims. Al-Muhim, one of the objectives behind giving bay'ah is that the Muslims become united and therefore the strength of the Muslims, it is preserved. In our religion, unity brings strength and disunity brings weakness. The meaning of bay'ah is that when there is a Muslim ruler upon the Muslims and his authority is established, that all of the Muslims then come together and they give him the pledge of allegiance, meaning that we will abide by your rules as long as they're in accordance with the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we hold you to be our leader. Like in the Muslim countries, we have rulers, Muslim rulers, and we have to obey the rules that they place as long as it's not against the sharia. If we all do this, then the Muslim country becomes strong. This is the meaning of bay'ah. And the companions, they gave bay'ah to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because he was their ruler, he was their Amir al-Mu'mineen. And then when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was Amir al-Mu'mineen, he was the Khalifa. And the Muslims gave him bay'ah. All of the Muslims came together and they united behind this one person as their ruler and the leader of their country, and there was strength. Now there's a new thing and a new innovation that people are doing. And that is that people are choosing this Mawlana, this Imam, this Sheikh, this Peer, or whatever they want to call him, and they give him this bay'ah. 5, 6, 10 people, they give him this one, this bay'ah. Another 5, 10 people go to another Peer or Sheikh or Mawlana or Imam or Wali, and they give him bay'ah. And like every group of 10, 15, 20 people, there are different Imams or Peers, and they give each one a pledge of allegiance. And it's gone so far now that now each leader or Peer or Mawlana, whatever you want to call him, he has a particular color code. So on his turban, he'll have, for example, a line which is orange, red, and green. And his 10 followers who have given him bay'ah have to have the same colors. He puts on a green cloak or an orange cloak, his followers have to put on a green cloak or an orange cloak because they have given him bay'ah. The other one, he wears another turban in another style with a red hat, he's supposed to wear a yellow hat, and now his followers have to wear a red hat instead of a yellow hat. And this is their bay'ah. So look, where is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and where is the action of these people? On top of that, as I mentioned, the bay'ah is done in order to unite the Muslims and bring the Muslims together under one body. And yet this bay'ah is done, 10 people with this person, 10 people with that person, each one then speaking against each other, you know, doing things against each other, and this only brings disunity. So bay'ah is correct, but bay'ah is given to the Muslim ruler and the Muslim leader. As for this bay'ah that people are giving, then this isn't from the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ.
Regarding the
people
of innovation, to what extent can we pray behind them?
First of all, the brother asks a question regarding the people of innovation, the people who are doing bid'ah. Are we allowed to pray behind them, or to what extent can we pray behind them? The first thing that we have to pay attention to, and this is a mistake that people are falling into, that we pray behind any Muslim. Any Muslim we pray behind it. Any masjid we pray. The masjid is the house of whom? Baytullah, the house of Allah. Nobody owns a masjid. This masjid is a waqf bought with the property and the wealth of the Muslims for the sake of Allah. So as Muslims, we pray behind any other Muslim and any masjid, and it's not an obligation upon us that we have to go now investigate. And this is similar to, for example, eating meat. Any Muslim, we eat the food and the meat, and we buy the meat from any Muslim butcher. We don't need to now stop, go and investigate and ask and question, what's your belief, what's your aqidah, what's this and what's that. And this is what the Salaf, like Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, mentioned, that Ahlul Sunnah, يَرَوْنَ الصَّلَاةَ خَلْفَ كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ بِرْلُ وَفَاجِرٍ. That the Muslims, Ahlul Sunnah, we pray behind any Muslim, whether he is righteous or whether he is disobedient. He has a beard, he doesn't have a beard. We pray behind a Muslim. We don't need to investigate. What's your manhaj? What's your aqidah? What do you do in your house? No. This is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, if it becomes clear that the innovations that this person is committing are innovations which are so severe that it takes him to the limit of kufr, then we don't pray behind this person. So we don't need to investigate and check. But if it becomes clear to us that this particular individual, this imam, for example, he is making dua to a grave, he sacrifices for other than Allah, he uses the jinn and he does magic, and these type of things, then we don't pray behind this type of person. Because this person himself, maybe his prayers aren't accepted because of this kufr. Therefore, innovations are of two types. We have an innovation which is bid'ah mukaffara, and we have an innovation which is bid'ah ghair mukaffara. A bid'ah which is kufr, which is disbelief, like shirk, like sihr, magic, using jinn. These types of things, this is an innovation, but it is kufr. Then we have other acts of innovation which aren't kufr. Disobedience, a person's iman is deficient, but it's not disbelief. The person who does bid'ah of kufr, magic, shirk billah, dua to other than Allah, sacrificing to other than Allah, seeking help from other than Allah, and this becomes known to us, then we don't pray behind this person. But as for the people of innovation other than this, then we pray behind them and there's nothing wrong with this.
In the past, when someone died, you would have people pay their respects at the home. And now I've noticed in the last 2-3 years that masjids are being used. So if a person passed away, they come to the mosque and they pay their respects and they sit.
And then they go in. Is this classed as a bid'ah, or is it not? The brother, Jazal Akhari, asked a very good question. He said, in the past, when somebody used to pass away, you'd go to that person's house and you'd give them condolences. In fiqh, we call this a ta'ziyah, giving condolences or dua or words of comfort to the relatives of the person who has passed away. Now we are seeing in some of the masajid, or even our own masajid, that people are now coming and gathering in the masajid in order to give condolences. And also, now they are booking community halls and things like this. And this is an action again which the Prophet ﷺ and the companions never used to do. In fact, more than this, the companions and the Salaf, they actually used to warn against this action. Because in a hadith of a companion, Jarir ibn Abdullah al-Bajali, he said, إِنَّا كُنَّا نَعُدُ الْإِجْتِمَاعِ لِلْمَيِّتِ وَصَنْعُ الطَّعَامُ لَهُ مِنَ النِّيَاحِ. That we, the companions, wish to consider the people congregating and coming together for the deceased person, for ta'ziyah, for these things, and also offering food to be from an-niyaha. An-niyaha was those actions which used to be done at the times of jahiliyyah. So this action of coming together, whether it's in a masjid, or whether it's in a community hall, or a part of a masjid, then this isn't permitted. The way to do a ta'ziyah, according to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, is, first of all, there's nothing that says that the ta'ziyah has to be done in 3 days. It can be done on the first day, within 3 days, after 3 days. Whenever you meet this person, you can give a ta'ziyah. Also, there isn't an obligation that you have to go to the house of that person. You can meet the person, if he's walking, you saw him somewhere, you gave him ta'ziyah. The main objective behind a ta'ziyah is words of condolences. You comfort him, or you make dua for him. Whether that's in his house, or whether that's somewhere else, no problem. In terms of cooking food, then the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is that because now this person and his family are occupied and are grieving with the death of their loved one, then the neighbors, they make food for this family. So this food isn't being given the name of the dead person or the remembrance of the dead person or for everybody. It's given for the family so they don't have to cook because they're busy. Maybe they've got some relatives coming, maybe the sons have come back home and like this. And also, now with regards to giving ta'ziyah in the masjid, if out of coincidence, the person whose relative has passed away comes to the masjid and he prays a prayer, and two or three people, they see him, they go to him, they sit with him, and they give him ta'ziyah, no problem. Because this intention wasn't to gather in the masjid and make this an event. And they didn't have any bad coincidence. But if it's an event which is advertised and given a name, for example, now in our culture, they say this is a puri. Mm. And I don't know what this name means, it's not even in the Arabic language. In fact, the letter pa isn't even in the Arabic language. I don't know where this has come from. Anyhow, these actions, Fatiha, Uri, whatever they call them, gathering the houses, men go to this house, women go to this hall, men go to this masjid, then this is not permitted. The Sahaba and the Salaf used to warn against this. Even if it is done in our masjid, it's still an innovation.
So I
belong
to في السنة الرباعية هل هناك موجود سنة رباعية كالصلوات الرباعية أم بدعة؟
لا فهمت. And answer in English. The brother asked a question that praying sunnah and what he means by sunnah is nafilah, not the fard, just the sunnah. Is there anything in the sunnah in which we should pray nafal or sunnah 4 units together, 4 rak'at, or is this an innovation? Meaning, should we be praying them just two sunnah, two nafal, or can we pray all 4 together? And there are a number of hadith which mention 4 rak'at. For example, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Rahimullah Imran, Salla qabla al-asri 4. May the mercy of Allah be upon a person who prays 4 rak'at before Asr. Also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to pray 4 rak'at before Dhuhr. 2 different narrations, the narration of Aisha radiallahu anha and the narration of Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anha. One narration says that there was 10 rak'at and this is only 2 before Dhuhr. Another narration says 12 rak'at of a sunnah ratiba and this is 4 rak'at before Dhuhr. So we know that there are certain hadith and certain instances where we should pray for. Now, after this, Aisha radiallahu anha, she mentions, كَانَ صَلَاتَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فِي اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ, that the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the day and the night used to be mathna mathna, in units of, in two units, 2 rak'at and 2 rak'at. And therefore some of the scholars, they understood from this that even, that whenever you're going to pray nafal, sunnah, always pray 2 rak'at and 2 rak'at. Even if you're going to pray, for example, 20 rak'at, pray 2 and 2 and 2, as long as it's nafal. The witr is different, because the witr is an odd number. And therefore, even the 4 rak'at before Asr, and the 4 rak'at before Dhuhr, then according to this hadith, in reality you should pray 2 rak'at, make the seam and then pray 2 more. This is your 4. However, some of the other people, they understood that now the meaning of four rak'at is that you can pray four rak'at altogether. But that which is correct is that the reason why the Prophet ﷺ mentioned four rak'at isn't because he was describing how they should be prayed, but because he was describing how many should be prayed. So four should be prayed, but in units of two and units of two. However, if somebody was to pray four rak'at, deducing this from this hadith, then we don't say that this is now an innovation, because he's basing it on a hadith of the Prophet. Yes, we can advise him, we can say, look brother, it's best to pray two and two, because Ummuna Aisha she said, mathna mathna, and this is the better way to pray. But we don't say that this is an innovation like Eid Milad al-Nabi and making dhikr in this way and all of these things. It's not like this, because there's a hadith that they are basing this upon. And one more thing, the reason why I mention these things is because this is common amongst our communities and sometimes people have misunderstandings. Making dua together, raising your hand, we know this is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The dua, the supplication, it has certain adab, certain manners. From the manners of the dua is you face the qibla. From the manners of the dua is you raise your hand. From the manner of the dua is that you do it in a particular way. Some people, after finishing their dua, they put their hand down like this. Other people, after making dua, they wipe it over their face. And some people, they consider wiping over the face to be an innovation. Now, regarding wiping your hand over your face after dua, then there are two hadith regarding this. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after he made dua, he would never put his hand down except that he used to wipe over his face. However, many of the scholars, and amongst them Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he mentions that despite the fact that there are two hadith, both of these hadith, they are weak, and they are very weak, and even when they are brought together, then they still remain weak. So therefore this action hasn't been established in the authentic sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with an authentic hadith. However, we have another group of people, and maybe some scholars, and they say that yes, although both of these hadith are weak, when they come together, then there's a level of strength to them. They become hasanli ghayri. And amongst those scholars was Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar, rahimahullah, the great Imam of Hadith. They call him Al-Hafidh. Now, despite most of the scholars saying no, he was wrong, and they are weak, and despite us not doing this ourselves, we don't treat this action like we treat those other acts of innovation. Because here there is a hadith, although it's weak, and there's also a great scholar who said, no, this hadith, they are both hasanli ghayri. So if we find a person that's doing this act, we don't become severe upon him and say, no, this is a bid'ah. Because he has a great imam, Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar, and he has a hadith which he considers to be authentic. But we advise, we clarify, that we don't treat this action like the actions of innovation. These things, it's important that we differentiate between a misunderstanding which is based upon a hadith and then something which has no evidence and no proof at all. Wallahu a'lam.